there's a difference between moving and dancing. Now, my definition of moving is the basic, I guess, Webster's definition of traveling from point A to point B, anytime, anywhere, no specific meter time, no specific destination, you know. Just something that wasn't here now and is somewhere else then, you know. That's just moving. Anybody can move. Moving to music, still, anybody can move. Moving to music on beat, that's something else. So, I honestly believe if you can walk, you can dance. But for some, it does take a little bit more work to be aware that there is a structure of a meter time that you're working within. Now, when you get more advanced in being familiar with that relationship, then you can go out of time and then roll back into time. But if you're doing out of the time all the time, then that's a totally different thing, you know? Yeah, so movement and dancing are not the same. Though dancing does encompass movement, but I don't think movement necessarily encompasses dancing. I don't think so. I mean, you could think of 1,000 cases where it can, but, you know, for me, just my take, for me, it's not the same thing, at least not what I'm thinking or where I'm coming from. What makes a dancer? Now, that depends, because the reason why I say that, I come from a generation that it was organic. I come from a generation that we were allowed to explore and be free in a very safe environment that was neutral to being being bombarded with criticism, opinion, pressure. We were allowed to just be who we were. That's not the same now. So, for me, a dancer was just something that you did. Now, a dancer for performance, like on stage, that's something different. So to answer the question in regards to performance on stage, I would say a dancer has to be one who is very connected to his body or her body to very well translate whatever story that's being given clearly to your audience. A dancer also is an athlete. So since your body is your tool, you have to take care of your body, and your body has to articulate very clear messages that your audience is supposed to get. But now, that's performance for stage. A dancer as a lifetime dancer, meaning doing this dance or any dance for no reward, for no purpose other than the pleasure of pushing your body to the limit, that's a whole nother ball game. You know, a dancer in that regard is one who does things and dances for the right reason. For us, it was an emotional thing, what I mean for my generation. A lot of us, it was our escape to not have to deal with whatever situation is happening at the time. Maybe just for a short time, maybe 12 hours, we could forget about it and just do our thing. But as we're doing that, and as we're having fun, and as we're pushing our bodies, and we're being inspired by everybody in the room, you know, there were trained dancers that were there that had money, maybe that took classes and so on. And what we did is, oh, you did that step, that's kind of cool. Show me how to do that. Oh, da-da-da-da-da, show me how to do that. Show me how to do that. And I have a saying, your feet tell me everything I need to know. I can tell where you're from, I can tell if you practice, I can tell if you don't, I can tell if you're genuine with what you do, I can tell if you're phony or fake. You know, your feet tell me everything I need to know. And that's only because organically in the scene, we've been dancing for so many years, every kind of situation rolls up. I can even tell if you're drugged up by your feet. So that's information that you don't get in a classroom. That's why my saying is life is class. Pay attention. You can't study the night before to pass the SAT. Boom, life is class. So the club is the classroom. Back in my time, we didn't have this situation where you can have, you know, classes and learn about hip hop, which, and I must say, hip hop now is a term that's loosely used for all urban dance and urban dance styles. I come from a time where hip hop, there was no such thing as hip hop. So I can tell you that this thing is something that's a label that's being used to encompass the broad spectrum of urban dance. That means dance that's in the streets, dance that's, you know, done by the youth or a town or a village or whatever. The whole concept of hip hop is a good thing for the fact that it does unite the youth. You know, you don't have to know the language, meaning verbal language, to get it in, and that's important. But also, I think the youth now are more geared to finding out, or wanting to find out, the information, which is good, because it's like anything else. If you live in your town, you live in your town, you don't wanna, that bar over there might have history. It's just a bar, you know? But if somebody else comes into your town, they're like, wow, that's kind of cool. Can you tell me about that? You know, that's the big thing here. Because in America, we don't even know our own history. I mean, it's there, but because it's there, it's like the Empire State Building. It's in New York. I don't need to go there because I could just see it, you know? But when people come and they go into a place of another culture or another situation, and they really want to know and ask questions, that's one thing I can respect about the Europeans, because, you know, it's not their culture, so you have to ask questions, and they're really concerned and interested. So I think that's a good thing. But like everything else, some things are lost in translation. And that's where my generation has to come in and just clarify. That's all. You can do whatever you want, but at least know what you're doing or where it's from. That's all I say, you know. And I think it's that's a mantra, I think, that you're supposed to use throughout life anyway. I think it has a lot to do, well, how I grew up. I mean, Caribbean people are always around music, you know. And I'm pretty sure while I was in my mother's stomach, you know, music was played, and I'm pretty sure I felt those vibrations, I'm pretty sure. Because ever since I was small, I've always been dancing since 3 years old. And I think when dance becomes part of you, that it's like breathing, it's hard to put a finger on that because that's just something that you do. But it's something that gives you joy. I mean, I don't do drugs, never drank, never smoked, you know. I mean, dance is my drug. That's what I've been doing since small. But for me, now, here's the thing. People see the dance, but it's not the dance. It's the music. It is not the dance. No, 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 no. It's the music. Because, you know, dance is the byproduct of the music. If the music does not move you, does not touch you in a certain way, it does not give you that motivation to move at all, you know. When music takes you over, you just, well, at least for me, it you want to be part of that. So you have this beautiful thing that's happening, and you try to mend yourself or meld yourself with this beautiful thing. That's how it's always been for me. And then there's sometimes where you know, I, you know what, come to think of it, no. There, I was trying to think of sometimes that I'm distant from it, but no, it's always, no, it's always an aspect in my life. Because I do know if I ever stopped dancing, that would bother me badly because of the music, you know. If I wasn't able to move, well, I'll have to figure something else out, you know. As long as I got a finger, it's gonna go, you know. So I think for how music takes me over, it's a symbiotic relationship. You can't, it's not separate. It's not mechanical. Some people can be mechanical with dance. Like, for instance, if it's a job. If it's a job, okay, 5, 6, 7, 8, 5, 6, 7, 8, blah, 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 blah. Okay, next. For me, that's not life for me. Though I do not make my living as a dancer, because back in those days, there was no market for that at all, and we didn't think of it like that. Now that I am teaching what I do, I like to say that my approach is organic because that's how I was taught. I was taught in the club, but that's why I have that statement, life is class, pay attention. See, when you're not doing the drugs, you can be aware. There's a lot of cats I know that are not here now because they got so wrapped up in the scene that they figure, oh, I gotta do this, I gotta do that. Knowing damn well that's not going to help you in the end. A lot of them aren't here, they're dead. You know, that's why the saying is very important. You can be in the scene, but not of the scene. Take that with you. Be in the scene, but not of the scene. You don't have to get down with all that other bad behavior, all that crazy shit. You don't need to do that, you know, because it's not gonna help you in the end.
But you've been there.
I've been in the scene, but I'm not of the scene. I didn't do the drugs. The music was my drug. Like, you know, that's interesting, because my mom and dad, they did allow me to be up to a point, because my mom wanted me to be a preacher. She did not want me to dance at all. When you're a kid, yeah, it's cute, it's cute, it's cute. But I guess when she saw that it started to go a little further, she was like, no, no, that's the devil's music. Why are you dancing to the devil's music? She was heavy religious, you know, Seventh-day Adventist. And it's almost like being Orthodox Jewish, I think, you know. So there's a lot of restrictions. And, you know, I'm very like, baby, that's your thing. That's cool, you know. But me, I got to do my own thing. And that's where we clashed a lot.
You know? Good morning.
Oh, yeah, man, we clashed. See, my mother was a seamstress. She used to sew in the evening and sleep during the day. So when I got my first job, it was in a movie theater. So she would sew in the evening, I'd work in the movie theater, close the movie theater at 12 a.m., and then go to the club, because the club opened at 12 a.m. and stayed open till 1 the next afternoon. So what I did is I went to the club, and I came back like maybe 4 in the afternoon, Sunday. By that time, she was asleep. So I didn't have to deal with I didn't have to deal with that. I mean, sometimes she caught me and then I used to get it. She used to walk after me spraying, because, you know, back in those days, they smoked in the club. So when I come in the house, the smoke would be following me. And she'd go,
Archie,
she would give me all that heat, you know. But, you know, when you love what you do, you just do what you do.
You're talking about your mother. It's like you're living only with your mother.
No, see, because my dad, he was slick. My dad, if my dad spoke 8,000 words in his lifetime, I'd be surprised. Because my father is very, boy, yes, no, okay. Because it was a traditional role. He was the kind of guy that was the provider. I knew him as my dad, but as to say I know about my dad, no, he was very with that. And because, you know, in my mom's family, the women are very dominant. So, you know, my dad just let her do what she wanted to do. If there was something that he really had an objection to, he'd just bark once. she shut it down, you know, but he gave her a lot of freedom to do her thing, you know. So her job was to keep us in line, you know. But the problem to that is if you hold on to your kids too hard, they run, you know, and that's what I did.
But in a certain way, family,
that's what they do. Because they didn't know. They're first generation West Indian American. So you're going to take your roots from home and bring them to the country, right? But America is not the West Indies. They're good parts of it. Well, they come from Dominica, Rosso. But I was born in Curacao. So my birth certificate's in Dutch. I left here, I left Curacao when I was 1 year and 8 months old, so I don't know anything about it. But I have my birth certificate and it's in Dutch. I kept looking at that and I said, wow. I can read it. I can't speak it all that well, but I can read it.
You've been in Holland.
Oh yeah, I've been coming to Holland since 91.
You tell the people. Yeah. Something about it.
Mm-hmm. Holland's fab. Let me tell you, in the 90s, Holland was hot.
Hot!
And you know, I'm a party kid, so, you know, Holland was the place. The Trut, the It, the Roxy, Exit, Havana, all these places were smoking in the 90s. I mean, smoking, oh my God. You know, and come to find out, John and I have the same history going through the same clubs here, you know. Because actually, I didn't know that was him in Havana. Because his whole crew used to hang out and do their thing in there, which was really cool. But we all vibed, and, you know, we didn't
know. But how did you come there? You were on holidays or?
No, teaching. SNDO, School for New Dance Development. They took a chance on trying this
program. You were living in Holland?
No. I came to give a workshop in 91. And it was for SNDO, School for New Dance Development. It used to be on the Costa Cabe. And I was invited to give a workshop. And then, but I told the kids, I said, well, listen, guys, you know, giving a workshop in a classroom is, but the club is a classroom. So I need for you to find me a club and we hold class in the club. So they found Havana. And back in those days, Havana opened, it was a bar. At 11 o'clock, they opened the upstairs for dancing. So we went upstairs and it was dancing from 11 to 1. And we ripped that place apart. It was, oh. And that's why I met Cassie Six. And Cassie Six, he's a DJ that we just reconnected now after 17 years. Oh, so the people that really inspired me throughout my life is, what actually made me who I am today is my Aunt Norma and my mother. You know, my dad was more of the quiet type, but very disciplined. So I think I have a combination of his discipline, definitely my mother's creativity, but my aunt is the one who exposed me to the arts. In things of as they say, in the world, my aunt had to sneak my brother and I out to see our first movie, 1960, I think it was 1967, we saw The Sound of Music. That was the first movie we ever saw. Then she took us to see Hello Dolly, then she took us to the circus, and my mother never knew. I thought she did, but Carlos told me, my brother, that she never knew. My aunt snuck us out, so I'm like, wow. And you know, my aunt and my mom used to dress really fashionable. And the funny thing is growing up though, my mom always used to dress me in browns and grays. I hated that because As an adult now, I've always been, well, my first talent is I'm an artist. I went to school for art. I'm very sensitive to colors. So after going to art school and being an adult and all of that, you realize that browns and grays are neutral colors. They're supposed to like blend in with everybody else. And that's basically what my mother wanted. I guess to be in America, but just to blend with everybody else. Don't stand out, don't make noise, don't blah, 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 don't such and such. And dressing me in those colors, whether subconsciously or or on purpose, put me in a box that I was not supposed to stick out. But the problem was, I'm 6'4". So I'm gonna stick out. So going to school, at the time I was the tallest kid in the school. But they tried to get me to play basketball, but I had no coordination, which is weird because most dancers don't. It's hilarious. They just bump into shit all over the place. It's hilarious. But I mean, I have right now this toe and this toe. I have two black toenails from bumping my feet into stuff. That's just how it is. But so getting back to the color thing, that's why till today, the loudest colors I can find, I will wear. And my wife is like, oh, he's whistling. Because West Indians love loud colors. Well, you know, I'm in America. I want to dress wild. At one point, I dyed my hair blue-green. I stripped it, I took a strip here. I bleached it white. And back in those days, they had crazy color, which was this hair dye thing. And it was peacock blue, so that's a blue-green. And I put it in my hair, you know, wait till it dried. And when the sun hit, bang, it was like, ah! You know? Well, I got a lot of heat from that. Lord have mercy, what wrong with my son? You got rainbow in him head. Jesus Christ, and I didn't think. And I was like.
Once again, please make some noise for Archie and Bravo. Yes, yes.
Things, they stay with you because, you know, I mean, my aunt recently passed away and I'm like, wow, you know, I guess it's an old world thing. You don't think of your parents getting older. You don't think of your aunts and uncles getting older. And then next minute, they're not there. You're like, wow. Even till today, because she just died May 15th, I'm still saying to myself, did that happen? I mean, because that's like my buddy. Did that happen? You know? So, I honestly think that the people who inspire me in the beginning, now that's parental-wise. Now, the things that inspire me dance-wise, because in those days, you know, we were poor, we didn't have no money. She couldn't send me to school or anything like that. I mean, dance school. At 12, she did try to send me to ballet school. I think I lasted 3 months, and then the discipline, I was like, I ran. You know, but then again, the kids used to tease me because I had to wear these red tights. And back in those days, we had briefcases to go to school. So I had the red tights in the briefcase and my books. So I had to go to class after school. The kids are cruel. So, you know, I opened up my briefcase to get my books and my red tights on top of the thing. So one of the kids grabbed my tights and run around the class. I came back home, mommy, 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 I don't want to go back. So I never went back. But I do know, had I stayed with ballet, I'd have been furious. I think I like the way I developed now, but I think I would have had more more ability to do more, you know, because it's a different discipline. See, I think life is about balance. If you can take the principles of ballet and apply it to what I do, that would be ferocious. But it can't be too much ballet. For me, ballet is the basic for your center and all that stuff, because I want to live, for me personally, I want to live in the funk side, the earth side. That's me, you know, because you know, traditionally ballet is a European thing, and to think of it, ballet used to be a social dance. That's the only way where the aristocracy can come and see women in, see what women's like, because you know, that was kind of pornographic then, for women to have tights and so on. That's the closest that they can be naked. So the boys would be like, yo, you gonna go see that? You know, to be quite honest, you know, it depends on what stages of my life. All throughout the whole stage of my life, my aunt, that's for sure. As a kid, television, because that was something we weren't supposed to have. It's just that I wasn't supposed to see what I wanted to see, which was Soul Train. And that was around 1974, I think. 1974, when Soul Train came on TV, I was hooked. But here's the thing, Soul Train came on Saturday. And for Seventh-day Adventist, if that's the seventh day of the week, because the week starts from Sunday to Saturday, and that's the Sabbath. So I wasn't supposed to see it. I wasn't supposed to do anything from Friday sunset to Saturday sunset. And I was not having it. So me and my mom always got into it, because I wanted to see Soul Train. I wanted to see them dance, because she wouldn't let me out. So I wanted to find out what the new dances were. So that's why when I finally went out into the club scene, I was dancing with a California flavor in New York, and I stood out anyway, you know, which kind of made me go, made it like this kind of attention, like, oh, well, what's he doing? Now that was when I used to go to the regular clubs. When I found the underground, it was the home, because I could do what I learned from the television that became me, and I wasn't being judged. And I thought, wow, this shit is cool. As soon as I got in there, I was hooked.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you name some places, like...
I can name them all.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Ah, ah!
Yeah.
Okay, the places of the place we used to hang out.
Yeah.
The Cochrane. Now, this is in New York City. Sound Factory Bar. Sound Factory. The Cochrane. The Palladium. The Garage. The Loft. Baseline. Plato's Retreat, Melons, The Anvil, Hellfire Club, Galaxy 21, Ipanema, Gotham's West, Gotham's, Roseland, Styx, let's see, was it Peppermint Lounge, Electric Circus, Inferno. I even did Disco Fever in the Bronx. Broadway 96, which became Broadway International. Copacabana. The Red Zone, which became Red Parrot. Studio 54, we did. Bonds International. You see all these clubs? This is what we did like every day. There was also, Vitamina, the Vitamina parties, House Nation parties, the party called Friends, The Choice, which was an offshoot of The Loft, what was it? The Ozone Lair, which used to be called Player's Choice, Ice Palace, 57 West 57th Street. That was hot. Ice Palace. What was the other joint? Ice Palace, New York, New York, Ipanema's. Let's see, because the hustle days. I did say Galaxy 21. I think That's the short list that comes to mind.
Okay.
I planned. But I planned to be back in January, you know, back in Amsterdam, actually, for the School for New Dance Development. But I have to see how that works with my time, because, see, the deal is, as a dancer in New York, you have to maintain certain things. Now, in order to be successful, this is a key thing for anybody listening. If you're a dancer in New York, I don't know if it applies here, but a dancer in New York, in order for you to be successful, you have to have a support system. And what that is that somebody has to be home paying the bills so that you're able to do what you need to do. Now, if you don't have that, then the only thing you're gonna have to do is sacrifice sleep. I work 4 jobs. My day job, which I've worked, been on that job for 27 years.
What is your day job?
I work for the New York City Transit System. I work for the trains.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The night job, which is my dance at Perry Dance School.
That's in New York?
In New York. My, these jobs, when I leave to come and do workshops. And the fourth job is I manage my mother's home, the home that I grew up in.
Yeah.
You know, I'm a landlord, so
yeah.
You know, I manage that also.
Yeah.
So that's why when I tell kids, point of fact is, like the commercial says, just do it. Because the facts are, you know, when opportunity meets preparedness, if you are not prepared, the opportunity will pass you by. So you have to get your education, you have to get your skill, you have to do it. It's not a maybe. Some people say, well, that didn't work for me. I quit school and I did so and so and I wholeheartedly put myself in there and I became successful for such and such. Understand what I'm about to tell you. When you do that, that means you accept the fact that if that shit don't work, you're gonna have to deal with what comes out at the other end. What that, like I'm saying, what that means is you already made it up in your mind that, okay, I'm good with the consequences. That's fine. Well, I come from the premise, because when I was in high school, I was a tutor, a math tutor, still editor of the art of the yearbook, the art division of the yearbook. I ran track and I was an artist. I did 4 things at the same time. So I've been learning how to multitask ever since I was small. So what I'm saying to everybody out there is don't bitch about it, just do it, you know.
Okay.
It's not gonna be easy. So love to me is the most essential thing in dance. Without the love in the dance, I'm saying, and I don't care who is hearing this, there is no dance without the love, because that's some bullshit. There is no dance without the love. Now, dance is a vehicle for you to express whatever emotion you're feeling. But if you do all this aggression and all this evil, bad shit that just has to come out of you, well, you know what? That's something else. That's not dance. That's some other shit. Choke on that. I don't give a fuck. Choke on that. That's some other shit. But for what I see now, in this generation, a lot of the love was lost. Because it's a twofold situation. My thing is that the love needs to be put back in the dance. Now, the battle situation is twofold. It's great for people from other countries to come and meet each other and vibe, and you get a whole new friendship, and you know, it's like literally hands across the world. But whenever you deal with competition, they say winner, loser. That whole concept of winner, loser means that the one who loses indirectly is lesser than. That I'm not down with. I never did a dance competition in my life. I don't need to. I don't need to be validated by anything. I know my place in this journey of life by dealing with the journey. For instance, if you concentrate on the end, you miss all that beauty that happens in between. And that's what these kids do, because they feel that, well, you know, if I win a contest, then I can work, and I can this, and I can that, and I can this, and I can that. So now, the dance for them became a skill, a little stepping stone for them to go do what they need to do. For some people, that's valid. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the fact that you have to dance for the right reason. You have to dance that it fuels you. You have to dance that there is no reward. That's a real dancer. When you do that shit in the dark that nobody's been watching you because you need to get that in, that's the real deal. All this other shit is bullshit. That's why, you know, don't get me wrong, I am so honored that they'd even want me to come to judge these things. But I understand opportunity means preparedness. My job right now in this circle is to let these kids know it's not about that. If you call yourself really getting it in, it's not about the prize money or the trophy. No, it's about the social, what's happening with you vibing with another person, continuing that story on and on and on. It doesn't start with us, but it continues with all of us. That's the issue. This shit about, I made this, and I. No, that's some bullshit. It's about we. That's how it goes. You know? But once again, these kids, nobody was telling them that. Nobody, the elders, me and my crew, nobody was telling them that. Because we were so busy involved in life, had kids, moved on, and this, that, and the other. We didn't know people were watching us. We didn't know that the next generation was looking at us saying, damn, I like that feeling. I want to do that. I want to get that. But remember, everything is about perception. If you see something and you think that's what it is, you're going to go on what's relating to you thinking that's what it is. But if you speak to the person that you're getting the thing from, they say, no, that's not what our motivation was for doing that. That's where things get lost in translation. And that is not their fault, meaning the generation, that's our fault. Because we didn't realize that people were looking, people were taking notes, people were trying to figure it out. But you gotta figure something, but you can't, let's say, you can't get a full story figuring something out without speaking to the person. But there's no access. So you just run on what you got, because there's no access. So my job, the way I see it now, and for the past few years, is that I lived in a time that made me who I am today, you know? And that, in turn, that little information can help these kids find their way in their situation. Now, times are different, yes. But one thing that doesn't change is the love. The love does not change. When you take the love out of the dance, it becomes something else, you know? And that's the important statement of my life. You take the love out of it, it becomes something totally different. House is not aggressive. It is not. Hip hop is, or what they call hip hop is. Vogue is very aggressive, you know, because it was born out of that energy, you know. But house was never born out of that energy, ever. So when you're doing all of this, and da da da, no, that's some other shit. That's not it, you know. House basically is some love and freedom dancing. That's what it is.
Thank you.
as I like to call myself, the dancing dinosaur. You know, I'm 53 and funky.